Okay, while everybody's finishing getting seated, I want to briefly make a couple of comments, very brief, promise Leslie, about why we're starting the first panel with this particular topic. So, as you notice from the patient keynote, there's a lot of discussion about not only the patients being the center of the discussion of how we think about the products that we make and deliver to the market, but more often than not, as it turns out, statistically, those patients are in fact very frequently female, in some cases the majority female, and even in the cases where they're not the actual patient themselves, most of the time, the vast majority of the time, they're making the decisions for their family about healthcare. So this need to better understand how we reach the female healthcare consumer is something we actually have talked a lot about amongst ourselves on the organizing committee, so much so we've even talked about having entire events around it, but we thought that we would at least put our toe in the water here and let the experts on the panel educate us more, infinitely more than we know about it today, certainly me. So with that, I will introduce Leslie Trigg, who is president and CEO of Outset Medical, to kick us off on panel one.
Great, thank you. So we are super excited about this panel. I'm not sure that everything we have planned for you is exactly what Deb had envisioned. Because not all of it is strictly medical device specific. Actually, how many people in the room work for a medical device company? Okay, that's helpful to know. So we have also incorporated onto our panel women who have great expertise in digital, whether that's online or mobile, beauty and traditional medical device. So before I introduce the panelists, though, I would like to roll the tape to introduce our topic. This is the best way that we could think to introduce it.
You live a busy life. The last thing you want to have to worry about is your birth control pill. That's why we're introducing Orthoestrin, a new low-dose daily birth control pill with little to no side effects. Ask your doctor if birth control is right for you. Then ask your boss if birth control is right for you. Ask your boss to ask his priest. Find a Boy Scout and see what he thinks. Tap a mailman on the shoulder.
Sorry, I didn't mean to startle you.
Tell him you didn't mean to startle him. Then ask him if birth control is right for you. Put it online and see how many likes it gets. Ask an old black man and an Asian boy playing chess in the park.
Can I start this new birth control?
Then ask them how they became friends, because there has just got to be a story there.
I'm trying to get birth control, and I'm
ask someone who just got one of those cochlear implants and is hearing for the very first time.
Yeah, but can I get birth control?
Ask Jeeves.
I'm supposed to ask you, too.
Ask your mom's new boyfriend. Then ask the Supreme Court. Finally, ask yourself why you insist on having sex for fun.
No refills? I have to go through all this again next month?
Yep. See you then.
Can I have a gun?
Yep. Remember, that's your right.
Okay, so we are here to talk about how to effectively, and perhaps not so effectively, market to women. And here's why it matters, and some of you may already be familiar with these statistics. I was not. In full disclosure, I know the least about this topic compared to everybody else sitting on the stage, so I'm learning with you. But what I learned, and these statistics are thanks to Karen Long on my left, women account for 85% of all consumer purchases. I'm sure we're going to see a lot of head nodding. These are not necessarily surprising, but the scope and the scale did still surprise me. They make up 80% of all healthcare purchases. Women account for 93% of all over-the-counter pharmaceutical purchases. Female baby boomers are the largest personal care buying segment. And this one is sort of staggering to me. Women over 50, which suddenly doesn't seem that old to me anymore. It did a few years ago. They control $19 trillion, which is just like a shitload of money. $19 trillion. And they own more than three quarters of the nation's financial wealth. So this is why we're talking. So when I was asked to moderate this topic, I have to say it sort of seemed a little bit unnecessary to me, or I wondered, why do we need to talk about this? Because shouldn't be obvious to all of us in the room because we are female. I think what I've learned is it turns out it's a little harder than it looks, even for those of us in the room who think we might have some natural instincts in this area, sharing the gender that we're trying to target. But clearly it is a little bit hard because someone thought that this was an effective way to target women. This is maybe a wake-up call for me. I obviously have been had latent bipolarism, or that we all just share these traits. Talking too fast, yeah. Sleeping less, buying things you don't need, like the 200 extra Christmas cards that I overbought that are now my note cards. Been searching for a use for, this is vintage 2010. And then this actually was vintage 2009. So I'm spending out of control. So this is just a classic example. I think we'd all really agree this is ineffective marketing. We don't really, you know, probably need to spend too much time on this. What we are gonna spend the next 55 minutes and 11 seconds, if we talk fast, talking about are the three most common pitfalls, and then on the flip side, three success strategies that you can take forward as you're thinking about how to effectively communicate with women in your product or service area. And I'm gonna rely on these gals to help me do that. So let's get to some introductions. I'm really excited about the panelists. Karen Long is the president and CEO of Newell, which is a venture-backed startup developing science-driven products for women's sexual health. And we'll talk about her product, which is super fun. Did you bring it?
I did.
Yay! Samples in the back. And her first product that she will hopefully show us just launched. It's called Fira. And it's a device targeted at increasing women's sexual libido and arousal. She was previously the worldwide vice president of marketing at Acclarent and then held a number of executive positions at LifeScan. When she was growing up, she wanted to be Julia Childs.
Still want to be.
But not making any progress. No. And if she had any superpower, it would be breathe underwater. So that's Karen.
That'd help me at work every day.
Yeah, or just breathing in general.
Exactly.
Danica Harrison is to Karen's left. She's the vice president of consumer and brand marketing for Zeltiq. She builds consumer awareness and drives the kind of must-get-it desire for cool sculpting, which is a targeted fat reduction technology using proprietary cooling technology, which is really cool for those of you that haven't seen it, like a spot fat reduction. But we'll hear a lot about that. Prior to that, she was a partner at Rosetta, a digital health firm, and led consumer marketing at Tria Beauty. When Danica wanted to grow up, she wanted to be a judge. And if she could have any superpower, it would be stopping time. Good one. Okay, Andrea Mallard is the chief brand officer of Omada Health. Omada is a really cool digital health company up in San Francisco, and they're totally reimagining how the world avoids and reverses preventable chronic diseases such as heart disease and diabetes. Omada, I'm going to brag a little bit about it on your behalf. I was reading up on this. I was super impressed. They were named by Fast Company one of the 50 most innovative companies in the world and the number one most innovative healthcare company in the United States. Pretty nice.
It's all me.
It's all you, yeah, exactly. Prior to that, she was the design director for IDEO and helped shape, you know, numerous products from design to brand all over the world for women and men. When she was growing up, she wanted to be Nancy Drew. If anybody remembers that. I wanted to be Nadia Comaneci, by the way. That didn't really work out so well. But yeah, exactly. And about 200 pounds overweight. And if she could have any superpower, it would be universal multilingualism, being able to immediately integrate into a culture and seamlessly speak the language. And all the way on the left, we have Denise Terry, who's the CEO of Embrace Family Health, which is a digital health company for mothers and fathers and parents and families that she co-founded, cool story, with the OBGYN who delivered her own twins. So we'll hear more about that. Previously, she was the chief marketing officer for Day One. Many of you in the Bay Area have probably been to Day One, which was a retail and services center for expectant and new parents here in the Bay Area. She's founded numerous tech startups really targeting women and mothers. When she was growing up, she wanted to be a pediatrician. not a huge surprise. And her superpower would be teleportation, so that she could travel to a new place every hour, which is a lot about your personality. So, okay, so before we dive deep into the topic, I wanted to start with a more fundamental question, because I know we've got women here who are maybe are in R&D and clinical and regulatory and different disciplines outside of marketing. So I thought it was probably worth taking a couple minutes to step back and say, what exactly is marketing anyway? And what is brand? Is it like an ad? Is it a logo? Is it a website? Is it like a celebrity endorser? And I would love Andrea to talk a little bit about what the hell is marketing.
Wow. Well, so I guess the first question I ask everyone is, anyone here on the brand team at their... Okay, you actually all are on the brand team. So the first thing I would tell you is brand, or even marketing, people often think of it as the thing that comes at the end. It's the soft shoe at the end. It's the nice icing. And it's absolutely not. You know, brand, marketing, it's actually foundational. It is really just... It's foundation to your business. It is strategy. You know, Andreessen Horowitz often says that story is strategy, and I agree with that. What it means for me is that brand is actually your point of view on how the world ought to be and what your company's trying to change in the world. It is not, I think the old version of brand and marketing was about myth-making, right? It was about hand-waving, and I see it really as truth-telling and finding that really key insight about your consumer, about your product, about your point of view, and telling it in the most resonant, compelling way. So for me, you know, I always tell people, my whole office, I'm like, look, brand is the connective tissue that holds all of our departments together. And my job as chief brand officer is not just to come up with a clever ad at the end or to police the logos and fonts, which, by the way, is the one thing I don't do at my company. I don't at all. That's not what the brand is. The brand is me trying to identify what are the things that are going to set us apart in the market, and then filtering them across all touch points. So that includes marketing, it includes product, it includes sales. You know, you will see me football tackle our head of sales if he tries to go out in the world with the wrong story or an ugly PowerPoint or the wrong message. You know, I care what he says because that is our point of view on the world, and that's ultimately our brand. So I think for me, I mean, the one thing I tell anyone in this room is to stop thinking of marketing or brand as a cost center at the end that you do to pretty up what your product is. If you have not hired your marketing person yet, or if they don't sit at the same table as your chief product officer or your head of commercial strategy, something's wrong, right? It's fundamental to the architecture of what your business is and what it wants to be.
I couldn't agree. I'm going to jump in if I can.
Do it.
I couldn't agree more. I think a brand permeates everything we do, and developing a brand that really resonates with the customer starts with the customer. So when I think about what does marketing mean, I can't tell you how many med device companies I've been in where marketing is at the very end of the cycle. And it's like, how are you going to sell this? What tools are you going to make for a sales rep? And how are you going to make a sales rep use these tools? Really what marketing is including all of those people from the very beginning. So the very first conversation that we have with a customer before we develop any product, before we even think about developing a product, is marketing. All the way to the product, all the iterations of the product, the story we're going to tell about the product, the positioning, the messaging, the continual tweaking about that, the channels that we're going to sell in, the sales cycle, then all the information we get back from the sales cycle, coming back to product, coming back to our messaging, coming back to our positioning, because I promise you won't get it right on the first time. You might not even get it right on the second time. All of that is marketing. So from my perspective, marketing is the brand, and the brand is the company and the product. There's no place that we shouldn't touch. So for the marketers in the room, you should be friends with every person in your company because everybody is part of marketing. And for those in the room who don't belong to a marketing group, you are marketing. So if you're in clinical, if you're in regulatory, if you're in sales, if you're in product development, that's all part of marketing because it's part of the brand. And so I have a very holistic point of view of what marketing is.
That's great. Okay, good. Well, let me ask another sort of fundamental question. Is, you know, what's tricky about reaching the female healthcare consumer? Is this, you know, again, going back to when I got assigned this topic, I thought, like, what's hard about this? Is this hard? I mean, we're all women, and I, you know, speaking for myself, perfectly rational, totally non-emotional, you know, very logical at all times, non-emotional buyer of anything. So maybe I'll start with Danica. You know, what is tricky? Is it tricky? Like, what is tricky about marketing to women?
Well, I think, you know, one of the things, and it's interesting, at the beginning of that video, I don't know how many of you thought it was real, right? Because what you see in that setup of that birth control ad is how a lot of healthcare companies market to consumers. They try to portray women as kind of this one-dimensional, totally overscheduled, oh my gosh, I have to do my shoe and check my email and make the kids lunch, and I'm scooping cereal in my mouth at the same time. And while there's some humor in that, it also kind of reflects the stereotypical view of kind of this working mom. And I think, you know, one of the big things to realize is that, you know, women are not one-dimensional. There's not this kind of one-size-fits-all approach. And so you'll hear, I think, a lot of us talk today about really understanding your consumer and letting those consumer insights drive everything you do, from the product innovation to the marketing to, you know, the creative development to, you know, to everything that you do about that, your brand. And so, you know, I think that's one of the tricky things, is not stereotyping women into that view that you saw, because I think for the first 5 seconds, unless you recognized Amy, you were probably like, oh my gosh, this is, you know, this could be my commercial. Like, I'm showing this woman in her daily life, and you know, how many of us have developed ads that shows women in their daily lives? And so, you know, so I think that's the first thing. I think the second thing that comes to mind for me is just convincing women to take time and give themselves permission to prioritize their healthcare needs, whether it's aesthetics, which is the category I work in, or, you know, something more serious. But, you know, it is, you know, as much as we joke about it, women are very busy. They have a lot going on in their lives. And how do you break through that clutter from a media perspective? But then also, how do you convince them, once you reach them with that message, that your product is worth spending money on or spending time on? And so I think that's the tricky part, is kind of breaking through both from a media perspective as well as just their daily lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. So at the Denise, maybe you could comment on this, because at the same time, women are super hyper-connected. So yeah. It should be easy to reach them now.
Well, I believe...
And I'm gonna pop up your slide.
Oh, there's my slide. So we, as women, I mean, you're all women, we are hyper-connected offline, and I think the online world really just mirrors reality in the offline world. And so we know women, we have more friends than men. You know, we're more networked through our families and friends. We talk to each other more often, more frequently than men do. And so if you look at the social networking world, Facebook, Twitter, you know, Instagram, all the new mobile-driven social networks like Snapchat, and things like that, women dominate social networks. So if you take a look at this slide, we exceed men across all of the platforms except for, at this point, Twitter and also LinkedIn. So by, you know, between 10 to 25 percentage points in certain cases. So I think this shows, you know, shows me as a marketer that women are online, we spend more time online, we're more engaged on sites like Facebook. Women post, you know, on average 1.5 more posts and photos than men on Facebook. Men tend to like things, but they're sharing less of their lives and what they're doing versus women. You know, we like everything. So that's one thing I would say. The other thing is that I feel like it's easier to find women online because we kind of, we broadcast ourselves. If you look at Facebook, you know, there are more Facebook fan pages, you know, from women than men. And so if you're looking to find women online, I think you can find them through these online communities where we spend a lot of time on forums discussing our personal issues, whether it's health or family or other things. Facebook, Twitter, it's really easy to find us.
Any other comments you would add, Karen, about what's hard about women?
Yeah, well, my number one comment is you have to market with women, not to women. So, and that's just through lessons learned. So it's one thing to say I understand a woman because I am a woman, but it's not necessarily for your product. And so I think it's always important to market with women. So for that perspective, it's always bring them in the loop, whether it's online. It doesn't have to be physically bringing someone in, although you might. But you have to engage the consumer. So I think that's first and foremost. And then if you have a tough topic, like I have a tough topic, if you have a tough topic like sexual health, or if you're thinking about, you know, urinary incontinence or fecal incontinence, all the really personal things, well, then you have a bar that's even higher. And while you can get to women, it's really important how you do so. And there are some very traditional ways, and we'll talk about those things, but you have to get people to engage with you. And there's a lot of ways to do that. For those med device people in the room, some of the very traditional ways of just bringing people in and talking to them still work today.
What
Andrea, why don't you comment on, is it tougher necessarily to reach females than men? Is it harder or the same?
I think it's easier. I think here's the funny thing. I mean, women control something like 80, 85% of all the purchases, period. I mean, we really shouldn't even be having a conference about how to reach the female consumer. It should be, how do you get to talk to the men, right? Like, what's interesting is, what's been happening is, even though men, women are essentially in charge, you know, right now 90% of all creative directors at ad agencies are men. And they speak the language of men, they speak the way men want to hear, and then we try to sort of pink it up to make it a female thing, right? And I'm always saying, you know, like, pink is not a strategy, right? That is not, that's not a thing. And, it didn't matter what product I worked on. Honestly, if I had to choose a lane, I'd just market to the women. Women control all the car purchases. People don't realize that, right? So I don't want to see another shot of a man driving fast on Highway 1, right? If you can show me a shot of me getting my three kids in the car really easily, you know, and packing things in and going, that's what I care about, right? So I just think... So I guess I feel like it's not hard to market to women. It's hard to market to them when you keep talking to the men, which is what we're doing right now. But if you actually acknowledge that 85% of your audience is women, and it doesn't matter what category it is, it doesn't matter. It could be Viagra. Your audience is still probably a woman. That changes a lot of things. And it also, I would hope, make us demanding, if you have a creative partner, being a little bit openly surprised, why are there no women on this creative team? I'm confused. Say that. I'm confused. Why are there no women on this creative team? I think that's a very powerful thing that we need to start doing so that we're in this really weird loop that has never made sense. And I think the winners right now are the ones who are recognizing that and being very bold in the other direction and having very bold conversations to women about women's issues in a way that men haven't done it for the last 50 years.
Yeah, so I just want to make a comment on that. So a lot of the pharma ads, you know, we basically market to women or men, and we say, talk to your doctor about this, talk to your doctor, like, the doctor is the authority. I think we should make ads that say, talk to your wife.
Yes.
Talk to your wife about this. You know, happy wife, happy life. That's a really good motto. Make your wife happy.
Totally agree. The comment, I just wanted to add one more thing, because I think everyone in the room will face this at some point when you are marketing to women, no matter what your product is that not all women are alike either. So while there is a thread, I think it's really important to segment who your customer is, because, you know, for my product, it could be an 18-year-old or it could be a 75-year-old. And those are very different messages and ways of reaching that consumer, both with the channel, the positioning, the messaging. And so I think it goes back to the fundamentals of really knowing thy customer and who they are. And so I would be careful not to generalize that it's just women. And I think that's why while they're reachable, it's not super easy. You still have to do all the hard work to really understand your customer and make sure that you are speaking to them. And that's why I say marketing with them and not to them. That never goes away, no matter what the product is.
So we want to use case studies in this conversation as well. And I think this is a good time maybe to turn to one of them, which is actually a Zeltiq example. And I think the question that I had for Danica, and also in the case of Omada and Embrace, it's rare that you're ever going to be marketing just to women, right? Most of us are marketing to men and women in the medical device space. So my question was, do you need to use the same, should you use the same messaging? Should you use the same positioning? Should you make some gender-based choices, maybe even in terms of the channel strategy or the look and the feel or the tone of the message? So I'd love, Danica, maybe for you to jump in, and do you want me to show them the case?
Sure.
Okay.
So I just wanted to share some creative examples from our Cool Sculpting ad. So this campaign is called Fear No Mirror. And I'll show you how this came to be in a minute. We started with a very, very different ad. And in between, we had this couple. The campaign was this couple running on the beach. This was all luckily before my time, so I can make fun of it. There was this couple running down the beach, and this guy was in little shorts, and the woman was in this little string bikini, and they were running. And this prominent dermatologist in Chicago calls our CEO and says, I hate your marketing. And, you know, most of the physicians that we sell Cool Sculpting to are either dermatologists or plastic surgeons, and a large percentage is dermatologists. And she said, I spend every minute of my working day telling people to get out of the sun. And first of all, your ad has people running down the beach who have never needed Cool Sculpting. But second, they're clearly, you know, running and hanging out in the sun playing. And how am I supposed to hang this ad in my waiting room where I'm telling people to get out of the sun? And so it was an interesting point for us because it showed us not only do we have to think about our end consumer, but our physician customer as well and what they're willing to put up in their waiting room. And, you know, speaking of targeting women, one of the things we realize is that there's a lot we can do within the in-office experience as well. I mean, certainly the advent of smartphones has taken people's attention away from the in-office video loop and the patient brochures, but what we found is just simple things like an in-office digital photo frame, which we branded with Cool Sculpting and we rotate all our before and after photos, is enough to grab people's attention. I think it's gonna be hard to get people's attention away from their phone with a patient brochure that's in a little, you know, a little Slim Jim holder, but if you have something that's interactive, if you stick it at the check-in desk, it'll catch people's attention enough. So with the right campaign and knowing how to target women, you can really be successful. In terms of women versus men, I think it really comes down to whether or not the insight is the same. So for Cool Sculpting, there is this insight which we discovered, which was people really wanted to look great in their clothes looking in the mirror. There's this very emotional process that happens in the morning. Maybe you women all went through it today where you were deciding what to wear. You may end up with a small pile of clothes next to your mirror on your bed as you leave. But some women, it's very funny. You're like, you try this on, no, it doesn't work. Or you kind of, well, just put a jacket on top and no one will notice these rolls over here. But for some women, it's very traumatic. They go in their mirror, their closet every morning and look at the half of their closet that has their smaller size clothes and the other size closet that has their bigger size clothes, and they decide, am I a size 8 or a size 10 today? And they're trying to figure out which clothes they're going to fit into. And so what the promise of this brand was for both women and men was being able to put on clothes, look in the mirror, and feel confident. And so for us, all we did was show different models, and the same Fear No Mirror campaign resonated with both, though I would say there's a lot of brands I've worked on in the past where you couldn't just swap out a man for a woman. And I think to go back to the couple running on the beach, that was the previous marketing team's attempt to incorporate men. Well, we'll show that this is for men too by showing the man running on the beach. Well, as unrealistic as it is for a woman to be running down the beach, for a couple to be running on the beach, it's a poor attempt to kind of include men. But
I think you have a great example too that some of your physician end users have been more gender-based in their approach.
Exactly.
Shall we say.
So there's one of the, I don't know if any of you are in the aesthetic space, but if you are, you probably have heard of Dr. Grant Stevens down in LA. So he has a huge plastic surgery office in Marina Del Rey. And a few months ago, he opened up a whole wing of his plastic surgery office. So he does plastic surgery, but also cosmetic procedures as well that are non-surgical. And he opened up this whole wing just for men. And he had done all this research with men who are coming to their office, and it turns out they hate the fish tank. They hate the pinks and purples. They hate all of this stuff that he had made like so amazing, the waterfall in the corner. They hated all that stuff. They wanted leather couch. He has like ostrich walls. He has he has a urinal in the bathroom, and above it there's the a digital screen with the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue running through it. He has like neon beer signs, and he had this grand opening. I mean, people love it. And so what he's been able to do is show that with a very different type of marketing, you can reach a different consumer. Now in LA and in Orange County, the market is very saturated with aesthetics. And so he was able to do this and stand out. We've had people try this in other areas and it hasn't worked at all. Mm-hmm. But he did this huge campaign with ESPN Radio. He treated the local DJs, one of the sports announcer for the LA Kings, and had great success targeting men. It was very easy to reach them watching their sports. And by having this campaign, he was really successful, though again, this isn't going to work in every region.
But he knew that his customers.
Yes.
And that's a good point.
Yeah. What about in the online and mobile world? Do you guys both have platforms that need to reach men and women effectively?
Yeah, I mean, so chronic disease, you know, preventable chronic disease is fairly equal employer, right? So it affects both. It affects women slightly more. You know, our take on that was actually, you know, the way our program works is it's essentially behavioral medicine delivered digitally. And a big part of that is the human component. And so whenever we are targeting a population joins, we have health coaches that are actually guiding, one-on-one guiding the patients through or the participants through. And so what we did is actually just ask a very simple question to every single patient who joins, which is why are you here? You know, I think a lot of people assume they know, but you don't really know. And there's always, I always say there's the reason and then there's the secret reason or the, you know, the real reason. And it's part of our health jobs. It's part of the health coach's job. And we, you know, hire them specifically for very high EQ to get to that place and to understand that over time. And we know what you're going to say when you join, and we almost put that aside and say, we're going to ask you in week one and two and three and again and again and again. And we also, I think, too, the great point you made, you know, we have health coaches that are highly regional. So, you know, it's I won't be that great of a health coach to someone who lives in rural Mississippi, and I may not be able to relate to that woman. But guess what? A really great health coach who lives there and grew up in that environment and knows what that means and how hard it is to actually find the right kind of foods and be supported by your family to get healthy and all the things that go part of, you know, that are part of that, she's going to be great at it, you know? And so for me, the way we think about designing for both is it's really about bringing that constant empathy along the way and a real person who's often just navigating someone through this experience for our platform. So we kept our platform neutral insofar as that exists as an idea, but we use the content and health coaches to target and to make it personal to the actual patients, men or women. One other thing to mention is we have a lot of health content as part of the curriculum. So we're really guiding someone through, you know, a true behavioral medicine protocol. And right when I was, you know, initially hired, we were asking, okay, well, we need to find a medical writer who's going to write all this for us. And I was looking at all the writing, and I was like, I don't want to read any of this, even if I were a man or a woman. This is terrible. And so we hired the executive editor of Cosmo magazine. Not that I was a huge Cosmo reader, but she also worked for Men's Health. She was the Girl Next Door columnist. She could write copy, and she could write health copy in a way that people would really read it and understand. And even within Omada Health, I remember their sort of raised eyebrows saying, wait, who did you just hire? And I said, just trust me. This is someone who knows how to write in a way that's going to resonate, and that's what's been missing from healthcare. You know, I don't know why instruction, I mean, there's obviously regulatory issues, but when you're talking about your product or you're describing it, talk like a human being, you know, and make people, people are smart. They can get it even if it's a complex medical issue. You can explain it in a way that is understandable, and that's, I think, one of the big things that has made our program so successful is that people love the actual content, and they say, I finally understand what this physiological phenomenon is. I mean, a lot of people have type 2 diabetes and don't actually know what it is and can't really explain the mechanism that's happening in their body. And we have this beautiful genius writer who's actually brought that to life for people. They say, I get it. Now I understand what is actually going wrong and what's happening.
Do you, Denise, do you guys think about it any differently?
Well, so we're reaching primarily, our primary target are mothers, right? Because mothers are the CEO of the family, the chief medical officer. They make most of the decisions, especially once they get pregnant. They lean in and really consume a lot of content. And so we target primarily mothers, but also recently we've started having conversations with fathers, because fathers are should be just as involved and, you know, in the family healthcare decisions. And I think dads should split 50-50 who takes the kids to the pediatrician. So we are actually doing a very concerted campaign actually targeting dad bloggers as well as mom bloggers, and having kind of dad-to-dad conversations with men and fathers that are actually led by fatherhood experts. We're doing things like daddy boot camp classes that are targeted specifically at fathers. But did you want me to talk about the mom bloggers now? Or
let's touch on that a little bit. Okay. Yeah, a little bit later. I wanted to go to just one other Zeltiq example, because I think it's kind of a pitfall into maybe a success strategy, which is one more campaign. And I was hoping that you could talk a little bit about...
Also before your time.
Also before your time.
Yes!
Yeah, exactly.
In fact, when I interviewed, the CEO shows me the commercial, and I had never seen it. And he just said, you know, what do you think of this ad? And I was like, gosh, I hope this wasn't successful, because it was terrible. So we're not going to show you the video just in the interest of time, but I'll just quickly explain what happened. So there's a soccer game going on, and all of a sudden a streaker runs across the field, and the streaker is so funny and motivating that everyone in the stands decides to get naked also. And so they take off all their clothes, and the players take off their clothes, the ref takes off his clothes, and the announcer's going crazy, like, what's going on? And then at the end, it just says, let's get naked, cool sculpting. So it's a 60-second ad, 58 seconds were, like, the naked people all running around the screen, and then then at the end, it just, you know, and then to make it even worse, after it says, let's get naked, it says, reclaim your self-confidence. Because obviously you've lost it. And you walk around every day with your head like this, like I have no confidence anymore. So I just thought it was, you know, forget the whole branding aspects of introducing the brand name and not talking about the category at all. You know, I just think it was very condescending. I mean, I think it was a huge miss. The team at the time was extremely excited about it. The agency was excited. They actually did test it, and it tested well, which was shocking. I mean, if you Google it carefully because it has the word naked in it, but you can Google Let's Get Naked Cool Sculpting and you'll see the whole video. It's a really funny 60-second ad. It's just not a good ad. It's a funny video. Yeah. It's just not a good advertisement. And so, you know, the big thing was just understanding the target audience. Again, the insight with these women was they want to look good in their clothes. They didn't really care about looking good naked. This product is for women ages 40 to 65. Their goal primarily is to look good day to day in their clothes. It's not to prance around in a bikini, you know, hanging out at the pool. I mean, they may be able to do that, but for most women, it's just to look great in their clothes. And so what we did was when we relaunched the commercial, kind of, you know, avoiding the pitfall of kind of don't let fun and, you know, don't make Super Bowl ads where people remember the dog shooting out of the cannon, but they can't remember the brand. Remember some, you know, create things that are going to resonate with your consumers. So we showed women kind of looking in the mirror and, you know, getting dressed in the morning and pulling up their jeans and having some stomach fat. You know, the woman here on the left in the gray top and bottom, I mean, you know, she's a size 12, 14. I mean, she's kind of an average woman, and she has a little bit of stomach fat. She's not, you know, completely overweight. She's not a size zero. She's, you know, kind of an average woman dealing with someone that most of us look like when we look in the mirror. And so, you know, and same thing, we did this whole problem solution setup with the commercial where we just said, here's the problem. It's very direct. Here's what the cool sculpting technology does, because our awareness is under 5%. So all we really need to do is tell people what the product does. And then we use some testimonials of our target audience women. They weren't kind of tiny women who are in their 20s and 30s. All of our testimonials are women in their 40s and 50s. And the tagline now is see a slimmer you. Instead of let's get naked, because what we wanted women to do. So hopefully most of you think that's an improvement.
Should we vote? Not kidding. What about, I think this is a great example. When we were preparing for this, Andrea told a really funny story that I'm hoping you don't mind repeating again about kind of maybe pitfall number two, which is totally missing the critical consumer insight in product design. And maybe you can, this is an idea of that one.
So, yes. So we were working for a very large company, and they wanted to, this is about 10 years ago, and they wanted to bring baby formula. Imagine a keg, like a keg of baby formula that that you would just sort of pump into baby bottles. And initially they saw it as an engineering challenge, because the really hard part was to have an aseptic valve, right, that you could get it out but that would not contaminate with air or anything, the content inside. So it had been designed as a real engineering problem. How do we design this thing with the aseptic valve, and, you know, it's going to be great, and you have a keg of baby formula, and it's easy, and it's, you know, room temperature, and it's no fuss, moms are going to love it. And so they invited us in a little bit as proof of concept, and I happened to, so they actually had a bunch of engineers and then me, and I just had my middle child, and we went to this woman's home, and they said she loves it. She's an example of a consumer who loves it. And she was going on about how much she loved it, and she's using the device, and how it's going to be so much easier. And I said, where's your formula now? And so she took us to her pantry, and she pulled out the soup cans and moved away the cereal boxes and then reached back and got the formula. And I said, why do you feel guilty about giving formula to your baby? And, like, the engineers in the room all had a sort of collective, like, you did not just, you know, and it was a very innocent question. And she got very defensive. And she said, well, I don't feel guilty. And I said, but why are you hiding the formula way back in your shelf, right? And it suddenly, we realized that at the time, this was going to be a very high-end product, very expensive, and it meant that you would have put a keg of formula on your kitchen counter for every single person to see, and for every person to know that you fed baby formula, which at the time had just swung the other way. That was a real no-no. That was, People looked down on you for doing that. People judged you. And a mom who had said to us she loved this product, and I knew she would never buy it. She would never buy it because the formula she was serving right now was hidden, and she was ashamed of it, and she didn't want people to know. And as we got to talking to her more, she actually opened up about that. And by the end of the conversation, she was like, well, I think it's a good idea, not for me, but it's a good idea. And yeah. I mean, it wasn't only that one insight, but in the end, I mean, you cannot buy kegs of baby formula right now. And I think it was a very interesting moment where what I said back to the client was, you should have had a new mother in the room with you at every step of this design process. Mm-hmm. And the fact that you didn't, you've wasted so much money. You didn't, you know, maybe it would work now, but at that time, at mm-hmm. that moment, and the way the sort of culture was swinging about women and formula feeding, it wasn't going to work. And mm-hmm. and if they just had that right insight,
right.
It wasn't about the aseptic valve. That wasn't priority mm-hmm. one. It was, mm-hmm. I don't want to be ashamed of this
did
on my counter.
You?
No, did not thank me very much. Did not thank me.
Nightmare.
Yeah, yes, could be.
I noticed it's not currently on the shelf.
It is not on the shelf. It's not on the shelf.
This is kind of a fun one, too, because we couldn't show a picture of the baby formula milk keg, unfortunately, which we really want to do. But anyway, we found this one. I'd love you guys to react to this. Go, girl. Don't take life sitting down. I really hope nobody in the audience did this. I apologize in advance if anybody was involved in this. But it's not bad. I'm not saying, actually, I'm pre-biasing the answer. Sorry. What do you guys think? What do you think about this? From a design perspective, does this capture the critical consumer insight? Female urination.
So I don't know a ton about this, but...
Well, this is a surprise. But if it's a surprise question.
But if I had to just give my 10-second sort of gut reaction, so this idea, okay, wow. Well, so a few things. So this notion of women being able to pee standing up is kind of an interesting one. I don't think it's they want to do it in it. See, this is a sort of pseudo-female empowerment stuff that I really hate, right? Which is like it's a woman canoe. This could be a tampon commercial from 10 years ago, which is why it drives me crazy. It's a woman right. in a canoe in the wild. If she's there, guess what? She's peeing. Just it's no big deal. She'll just pull down her pants and pee. No problem. Whatever, it's fine. But I do think I think this is interesting. And but I wonder if the insight's more like, can you show a bunch of ads of just disgusting toilets that no woman wants to sit on, or an outdoor concert where there's a line for the porta potty 50 miles deep, and a woman says, I've got to do something now, and this is what the solution is going to be. You know, I don't know, but I think the insight is not I want to have a penis. I think the insight is. I think the insight is I don't want to have to wait, and that's disgusting. Yeah. And if those are the two insights, then I would focus all of your marketing to that moment, which is it's not about don't take life sitting down. That's a little. It's like get on with it. I don't want to.
It's always about the insight. It's always about the insight. Every comment that you're both making is we got the insight wrong to begin with, which happens frequently. I mean, we've all done it. Yeah. There's nobody in this room who has not got the insight wrong. But you have to go back and you have to try again, which you did beautifully. Mm-hmm. And the insight's wrong here. And I think that's just the point, is that you have to keep working at what is the critical insight that's really going to move somebody. It doesn't matter if it's moving a doctor to purchase your product or it's moving a consumer to purchase your product. You have to really understand that insight and then be able to message it in the right way that they get it in order to sell something.
What was the insight here for Tria Beauty or the Mist insight? I don't know which it was in your opinion.
Just for those of you who aren't familiar with Tria Beauty, they make at-home medical devices. So they have a hair removal device, a fractional non-ablative laser that's at home, and then a high-intensity blue light for acne. So this is the hair removal device, and this was generation 3.0, and it's interesting. So the company was founded by men. So it was founded by men who had created the first medical device, light shear, for in-office use for hair removal. And on their R&D team, there were no women. So talk about creative design. Also think about product development. I mean, those fields tend to be very heavily men-dominated. Mm-hmm. So it was founded by men. All the R&D staff was men, and they came up with this product, which... You know, the technology works really well. It was interesting when we actually partnered with IDEO to come up with the next generation of this. And, you know, there were quite a few things that in retrospect, they got wrong, and they just assumed because they knew the technology, they understood how women would use this device. And one of the biggest things was whether or not it should be corded. And I would say this is kind of still a big battle internally there, but at the time, the big belief was it has to be cord-free, because women are going to want to take this thing and use it all around the house. They're going to want to use it, like, watching TV. They're going to, you know. And so the downside of it being cordless is the battery only lasts about 30 minutes. Well, because if any of you are familiar with how professional laser devices work, the laser tip where the laser comes out is much, much bigger. So the downside of doing it yourself at home is the area that it treats each pulse is much smaller. So it is going to take you, you know, an hour or 2 hours. If you're doing your full leg, you could be sitting there for an hour. And it might be worth it because this product costs $400. And if you go for, you could do your whole body with it. And if you go for professional laser hair removal, you're talking in the thousands. So for someone who this is, you know, an important, you know, benefit for, you're more than happy to take that price trade-off. However, as it turns out, most people have plugs. Even if you did want to use it in front of the TV, it's much more convenient to have it plugged in and be able to use it for the full hour. The other thing is the weight. So it has to have such a powerful battery and all the technologies in this thing that the weight ended up being so heavy that if you're trying to treat your bikini area, your leg is like up here and you're like trying to treat your bikini, and after like 5 minutes, your arm's actually getting tired from holding this thing. And so
it's not a cordless drill.
Right. So that was, you know, the inspiration for that was probably like a cordless drill, or for the, even for the anti-aging device, when they started using it, the men were designing it like an electric razor. And they're like, well, women don't do anything like this on their face. No one puts on makeup or anything like this. So, you know, a lot of it was just, again, making sure that even the R&D team very early on understands who they're marketing to. It's not about getting the technology into the smallest size possible. It's about designing the product in a way that is eventually going to be happy for the end consumer. And I would say even for those of us, because most of us are selling our products to physicians, there's some products out there, and I'm sure you've seen them, or hopefully you're not working for them, but you know, it's a pain for that physician to use that product. I mean, they have to like wheel the big machine in, they have to hold something, they have to have come up with all their own accessories to make it easier for the patient. So even the products that are sold through physicians, just think about what that end consumer or that nurse or the physician who's administering the treatment, what their experience with it is like. And a lot of times, again, that's not thought of till the end.
So, okay, so we spent a lot of time talking about what not to do, and I'm going to guess that none of us are striving to fail. So I wanted to shift this a little bit in our last 15 minutes to maybe some common principles for success. What are like three success strategies that could be applied, I think, pretty broadly, again, whether you're in traditional medical device or services or pharma or digital, online, mobile, to varying degrees and in various ways. I think maybe on this one I'll start with Karen. And so we were just talking about the consumer insight. So what's sort of the success strategy, I guess? Can you give us a win here, like on getting it right?
Keep working at it. I'll go through a little bit. I think I'll combine maybe this with the research, because I think that's a good way to think about it. It does boil down to getting the critical insight. And for us, this is our product. This is Fiera, the arouser for her. So there are sexual concerns that affect all women. And for us initially, I didn't know the space. So the first benefit I had is I got to spend a long time learning. So I spent a year in research before we even started developing a product, which I know is not typically the case. So I feel very fortunate to have done that. And the insight that I was able to learn at the end, which shifted everything about product development, what the product looks like, what this package looks like, and the messaging, is that the motivator for women as it related to wanting their libido, so we're talking about libido and arousal, was that they wanted to get in the mood because they cared about their relationship. And that they knew that having a healthy sexual relationship was important to the overall health of their relationship. And they were motivated to have a healthy relationship. That is a far different insight than women just want to have a great orgasm. Women are really interested in having a great orgasm. Completely different products, completely different way of thinking. Because if the relationship is the insight, then everything we do is different. So that took a lot of research to get there. I had the good fortune of marketing with women, which means marketing is the very beginning, learning from women early on. Mm-hmm. So we did a lot of research, and I'm going to tell you, you can do all of this. We don't have big budgets. We're a VC-backed company at the time. We were a company coming out of the ExploreMed incubator, very small budgets. Craigslist, I put an ad in to talk to women. I had women phone. I'm luckily able, because of my background, to screen for crazy people, and so I screened. Tons of women wanted to come talk about their sexual concerns and the impact on their relationship. So I learned from them. They allowed us to videotape them. Had no problem recruiting from local Craigslist, coming and talk to us about real problems. Friends and family are always good. We had friends and family both for information and for product trial. I was able to do a lot of pilots and develop the product with women all along. So I always had women in our laboratory. And yes, our founder happens to be a man. And we have men that are engineers on our team, but we never didn't have women in the room. So women have been an important part, and I think that's a critical insight that can carry you on. You always go back and check. Today, I have women in the office at this very moment while I'm here who are testing the product. We launched a few weeks ago. We're still testing. We never stop working with, in our case, it's a consumer. In your case, it may be bringing physicians into your lab. You never stop. This is a process that keeps on going. Surveys. I wanted to find out about this messaging and what resonated. We can all use SurveyMonkey. So that's a tool that we are all able to do. You can take the time. You can fill out. You can look at the research. You can analyze the research on your own. So I did 3 SurveyMonkeys. I did pricing surveys, concept work. I learned how to do research I didn't even know how to do. And so what I would say to you all is don't stop learning and make sure that you are continually testing that insight that you believe to be true all the way till the end. And as we talked about earlier, once you get to the sales cycle, test it again and again and again.
That's great. I would also add, don't assume you know because you're female. And this is not unique to being women. I've worked with, as probably many of you have, a number of physician CEOs, physician founders, and have had many of them tell me, well, we don't need to do marketing because we're marketing to me, and I'm already a physician. So I'll just tell you what to do and how to do that. And that obviously doesn't work, and the same could be applied here too. I think it is easy. I've fallen into this trap myself. Just sort of relying only on my own instincts because I happen to be female is no more rigorous. So I think that's a great point.
Although I would say, when push comes to shove, you should listen to your intuition. So that is one tool that we have, that women in particular have. You should continue to hone that. And when push comes to shove, listen to your intuition, because you'll never have all of the data you need. It's really important to get it. Go out and do the work and get the research. But you do have to sometimes make decisions just based on what your gut is telling you.
One quick thing to add to that just may be helpful is, you know, if you, a way to test that to a certain degree, your intuition, something I learned at IDEA, I'm so grateful to have been there because we learned a lot of good techniques, but it was about having sort of unfocused groups of small, very small groups of women. So the goal isn't to remove bias from the room. So whenever I sat in a qualitative focus group where people are trying to be very careful, I think that's a mistake. You can do that on quant. In qual, if you invite extreme users, in other words, if you want to test where your intuition is, invite 6 women into the room and have 2 of them be extremes, non-users or pro-users. In other words, 2 women who are very embarrassed about their sexuality, never talk about it, don't feel permission, don't want this product at all. That's a very extreme non-user versus a woman who's very sexually open and liberated and advocate for this. The goal isn't to get the bell curve of women and try to appeal to them. I think if you can get the extremes, it allows you to test your intuition and to see where the corners of that canvas are. And I found that to be a really cheap and fast and human way to get that insight very fast.
And why do you call it unfocused groups?
Because focus, like, I mean, I've done these where we've gotten drunk, where I've had cocktails and we've just been chatting because I wanted the women to let down their defenses and I wanted them to not perform for each other. I wanted us to talk like actual people. We'd call it a girls' night in. We wouldn't even call it a focus group because I don't want a two-way mirror and a white and a moderator who's being very careful about their language. I just don't think that's necessary in qual. Do that in quant. But in qual, what you're trying to do is get those little insights and for people to say those little things that push you to think differently about it. Mm-hmm. Or that, I think that's where you find those nuggets of insights. And it's not if you're being too careful about removing bias and not trying to lead the witness. I say lead away. You want to push them as far as you can to see how they react or what they say to get those insights.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah,
early on when I first started working on the company with my OBGYN, Dr. Ridfors, I would just sit in the waiting room because he has a clinic in Redwood City, Women's Health and Wellness Clinic, with hundreds of pregnant mothers and new mothers bringing their babies in at every different stage. So I was literally, he just gave me permission to sit and talk, you know, and sit with women and have conversations like we do with strangers and find out about their user journey, you know, how has it been for you to be pregnant? What are your challenges that you face, you know? How's the new baby going? How's breastfeeding going?
Yeah.
And women just open up to you. You know, when you have these conversations, you can have them online too, on social media, and reach out to people and just say, I'm curious about your journey.
Yeah.
And so I think I learned so much, like even just in the 30 days sitting in that waiting room, that's the first thing I did, to really understand the patient, the user. What apps are you using? What do you trust? Where do you go to for information? Who do you ask when, you know, this problem comes up? So we really learned a lot about where women go to look for information related to their pregnancy first, and then their health and their baby. And they trust really other moms and their doctor.
So. That's a great point. I do want to get back to the mom blogs, which we need to make rapid progress toward. So the second, first insight is make sure you're capturing the critical consumer insight and think about how you're doing that, which is not necessarily a formal focus group with formal questions. And often should be fueled by alcohol. I think that's lesson number one. I think lesson number two takeaway is radical honesty, and I want you to cue this tape, if you can, as a great example of radical honesty.
First, Jenny got it. Then stupid Vicky got it. And I tried everything to get my period. Nothing. So, I faked it.
Looks like Florida.
Yeah, I got it. It's so red.
Cherry Slush Club.
Blood Sisters.
They bought it.
Hey, Katie. What's this?
What do you think it is? I'm on my ladies' days.
What do I think it is? Rubylicious nail polish.
But she doesn't need to know that.
We have to celebrate.
No, we don't.
Oh, it's family tradition. We're throwing you a first moon party.
Hell is a first moon party.
No, it's one thing to lie to me, but to take that tone, it's on. Hi, do you make vagina cakes? Hello?
Then people started showing up at my house.
Grandpa! Great to see you!
You're so grown up.
My grandparents? My friends?
This is so weird.
Good to see you. Good to see you.
My mom's frigging co-workers.
There she is. Hey, I got you the super pack.
These are coffee filters.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what brand you liked.
I just didn't expect my mom to be such a freak.
Pin the pad on the period. All right, separate up.
Pin the pad on the period? Seriously?
Do you know how hard it is to find a uterus pinata?
I used to like marshmallows. Not anymore.
This next one's for Katie. And the weirdest birthday party ever.
Mic drop.
I'm a queen bee, come get it.
When things couldn't get worse,
surprise!
My dad showed up.
What are you doing? You're missing the magician.
You need to stop this. No one is having fun.
What are you talking about? This party is a hit. Your grandpa is bobbing for ovaries like a champ.
I faked it.
Well, maybe you should open this first.
Period starter kit? Aren't you gonna ground me for lying?
Why do you think I threw you the first moon party? Would she think I wouldn't know? Periods don't have glitter on them.
Sometimes you just gotta wait.
We thought this was the best example of the principle of radical honesty, and I think a couple of things that jumped out to us. That I'll quickly summarize. Number one, first time we've ever seen red on a tampon. Normally, the guys that make these ads, it's some color of blue or green, like a kitchen product that's being dumped onto the tampon, and then these precise measurements of fluid absorption, which is exactly what we're looking for. What was your measurement? How much fluid did it absorb? I got 20 milliliters. So pretty cool. Again, very honest. It's actually showing red, which is kind of a shame that seems radical in 2015. I think second thing that we noticed was it really celebrated versus shamed. You know, periods, especially for young girls, they got an insight that they got a lot of insights right about the relationship between mothers and daughters, how girls Not all girls, but you know, a lot of girls do have this as a source of pride, almost in competition with their friends. They kind of got a competitive element in there. They got an insight about, you know, again, kind of making fun of clueless guys. It was all like very, very honest. And it showed a mother, a woman, who was really sort of smart and a little Machiavellian and funny. And that's kind of a new model that you don't see a lot. We kind of wanted to close with this because, you know, think about the orthoestrin ad for the pill, which those ads are still shown today all the time. To this and the vastly different approach that is so much more effective. So we really liked that. I thought that this one too is a great example of radical honesty and something that Andrea is familiar with. So I wanted her quickly to talk about what's cool about this and why is this radically honest.
Basically, it's a platform that explains to young women, not teens necessarily, but young women, what the birth control options are. And for each of them, it actually has women who use them explain it. So rather than a doctor saying, this is how you insert a ring, they had a very charming 19-year-old girl literally sit there and say things like, well, you twist it, and then you stick it up your vag. I mean, she was just using really hilarious, charming language. And here's what's not, you know, once it fell out at a truck stop and it rolled across the bathroom, and she's describing what happened. And that happens for all of these products. And I just felt like, wow, it's the first time I've heard a birth control talk about how it actually works from real women to real women, and also we do this because we have sex for pleasure as well, not just to prevent pregnancy, and that was actually just a common thread and taken as a matter of fact. So I just thought it was so refreshing, not to mention the fact that you can click on tabs that say, is this birth control good if you have to hide it from your parents or from your partner, or that this is party ready. I mean, this is just language we were not using for women, but I felt like it really, really resonated with this crowd.
Hormone free, I love that. So last lesson that I want to make sure we spend at least a minute on is being creative with channel strategies and thinking about micro-segmentation and micro-targeting. We've talked a lot about the fact that women are not one-dimensional. And so how do you kind of get after that? And we asked Denise to talk a little bit about mom blogs and kind of the mom world online as a good example of this.
So true confession, I was a mom blogger at one point in my 8-year career as a mom, and I turned my blog off about 5-6 years ago because my husband was like, you're getting too personal, don't share all this stuff. And so I turned it off, but I had quite a following, and actually I was very involved with the mom blog community before I even had my kids, because I was running marketing for Day One. And actually, short story, I had a small doula practice here in the Bay Area where I was supporting mothers during birth and labor. And so I was actually getting traffic from other mom blogs in the Bay Area, because the birth of the mom blog was really here in Silicon Valley. There was a group called Silicon Valley Mom Bloggers, and Blog Her, which is one of the largest conferences for women bloggers, not just mom bloggers, women bloggers, was recently bought by She Knows Media. And now She Knows commands about 75 million unique women views per month on their website and on their network. So this is a very powerful place to reach women consumers online, no matter what your product is. They have 150 million fans across social networks, which is incredible. So basically, women have ruled the blogosphere forever. And that's why we rule social media, because really, in order to be successful on social media as a brand and as a product, you have to have content to publish. So it's not just talking on social media and talking on Twitter. It's actually linking to relevant content that moves conversations and connects people to your message. And so in terms of kind of cracking the mom blogger network and market, I could teach a whole class on this, and I'm happy to talk to you about it later if you have questions. But basically, there's various ways to get earned media. I call them earned media versus paid media. So you're not spending your marketing dollars trying to blast ads to people through Google or other places. You're basically starting and opening conversations at scale with people that are interested in your message and your product. And the beauty of the internet is that, you know, there's this long tail effect where you might have a very, very small and targeted population that you would have trouble reaching through traditional media, print ads and radio and TV, but online you can find them. You can find them through these niche communities, you can find them through Facebook fan pages, you can find them on Twitter. If you just hashtag whatever it is your product, your top keyword for your product is, you're gonna find thousands of people talking about this. One of the hashtags that I follow all the time is, I am pregnant. I'm pregnant. People are announcing their pregnancies on Facebook and on Twitter. And so you can actually find people like in real time who are talking about your product right now. So one of the lessons, I guess, not related to mom bloggers, but make sure you have a social media strategy that is not about publishing content and blasting your message out to the masses, but it's about listening. And, you know, listening for conversations, listening for insights about your brand, listening to what people are saying about not just you, but all of your competitors. All you need to do is get on Hootsuite and start, you know, creating streams related to your products and your conversations, and you will learn so much about your customers from what they're talking about online. So in terms of cracking the mom blog network, there's ways to actually reach these mom bloggers, and they're the top 20 mom bloggers, they're all millionaires. These are like millionaire mom bloggers who make so much money just creating content every day. They write about their kids and their families and their dogs and whatever they write about. It's crazy. But brands are spending a ton of money to market through these mom bloggers. So there's a couple conferences that I would recommend you go to. There's Mom 2.0. There's these multiple conferences every year. Go there and actually, as a brand, you can sponsor a table. You can just be in the conversation and meet mom bloggers face to face. When you're at a conference like this, use social media, not just as a brand, but as an influencer and a spokesperson for your company. I encourage all of you, even if you're just listening on Twitter, to get on Twitter and listen to conversations. You don't actually have to tweet to participate. You know, take a photo of us, hashtag, you know, MedtechVision. Make sure that you're connecting with people at conferences. And then also you can sponsor them, but also, you know, if you have a PR team or a social media team, reach out authentically. So I follow all of our, as many users online as kind of follow us back. So reaching out to brands, to partners that we want to partner with, they'll oftentimes follow me back or follow our brand back, and we'll have actually direct message conversations behind the scenes. It's a lot easier to have, you know, open up a conversation or a partnership that way authentically versus like pinging somebody through spam or through your PR firm or sending a news a press release.
So success strategy, be targeted, think outside traditional channels, starting first with the right consumer insight. And I hope you guys got some great lessons. I did. I was actually been taking notes about how do you get the consumer insights, and then being honest and being relatable. My one last plug or plea is be brave. I think in medical devices, the norm is kind of, you know, purple and a woman and, you know, kind of jogging or whatever. And talking about stroke, you know, or like a steaming cup of coffee, talking about a stroke. And so my plea is like, be unorthodox. Not everybody will like it, and that's okay, because it shouldn't be targeted for everybody. The second that we try to make it appeal to everybody, we appeal to nobody. So my parting shot is like, be brave, be bold, and take risks. Any other parting shot? I know a couple of you had a parting 2-second shot, because we're getting kicked off.
My only parting 2-second shot is, I agree, be brave, and you are very brave. We learned from you. The second is, Newell is hiring, so please come see me if you're interested or know people.
Okay, we are too. Okay,
good. Yeah, we're all hiring.
Go ahead.
No, I think I just agree. I think it's about being radically honest, being unorthodox, not doing the status quo, and involving women as you're creating this co-design this with your patients and with the women that you're targeting.
I would say be authentic, listen, spend a lot of time with your consumers and your users, and I'm fundraising, so if anyone wants to come join me or help us, that'd be great.